How's it going, guys? My name is Zach with The Movie Castle, and today we're going to be talking about Friday the 13th, Part 3 in 3D. This is from 1982 and is once again directed by Steve Miner. Steve Miner directed Part 2, and he's back to direct Part 3 just a year later, so a bit of consistency with that. This stars Dana Kimmel, Paul Katrka, don't know how to pronounce that, and Richard Brooker. Now, Part 3 is the first film with proper hockey mask Jason. Jason was not the killer in Part 1. Part 2, he finally showed up, but this was Potato Sack and Pitchfork Jason, who was also a lot skinnier, but now we have the unstoppable Jason. We have him in his proper hockey mask with his machete, and all is right in the world, finally. So it's good to see proper Jason show up. He's bigger and he's tougher this time around, quite interestingly. They wanted to get the guy back who played Jason in Part 2, but he, for whatever reason, couldn't show up. So they needed a new guy, and this new guy that they were looking around, they found him. He just happened to be a lot bigger, and they're like, you know what, this probably is actually better. And Jason, being a bigger, stronger, bulkier guy, stuck through the rest of the series, you know. So you get to see Jason be a much tougher, stronger, harder to take down opponent in this role, in this movie, and it's good to finally see Jason in his full form, and I really did like that. Now, this is Part 3 3D, so there is some goofy 3D elements here. To those of you who are big fans of 3D movies, you'll probably really like this, but there is some parts that are a little on the nose and cheesy, but that being said, I think that's kind of part of it. You know, with this movie, you do introduce proper Jason, but having the 3D elements, having it be a little goofy, and having it have a little more fun, I think that's really a crucial thing to the series that this movie discovers, and it doesn't get talked about as much. Part 3, it kind of hangs loose a little bit, it kind of gets a little goofy, and in turn, it's like, hey, we're here to make a slasher, we're here to have fun. And this movie realizes that, and it really does work, and it helps move the series in the right direction. This movie is when we get the series becoming what it's known for, and even though Part 3 isn't the best of the series, out of the first four, 1 and 4 are my favorites, even though it's not the best, it does get the series to where it needs to be. It makes it to that iconic level, and it's the portrayal that would get reused in all the sequels, and it's the movie that helped Friday the 13th become what it is and get all the way to 12 theatrical movies. So even though this isn't the best, there's a lot there to like and a lot there to appreciate, really important there. We open up with a random couple in a grocery store getting killed by Jason. Now, right off the bat, you get a guy, he knocks down the clothesline, and he picks up the pole that's supporting it and puts it right into the camera. The first of many 3D gags with this movie, and you kind of know where this is going. You do get little bits where the guy's running around the grocery store, he's arguing with his wife, and he's doing things like opening up containers and eating food out of them and putting them back on his grocery store shelves. This was before everything was so sealed like it is today. So you get a few little comedic gags there, and then Jason will eventually kill them both to open up the movie. We then cut to our main characters there, and a big tonal shift for this one is we're now in the Lake House district around Crystal Lake. We're not at a camp anymore. We're not at a summer camp. We are at a house. This movie, the reboot, and Part 4, are kind of the Lake House movies. There might be a few that I'm just not thinking of right now, but yeah, we're going to be at Lake Houses for a little bit. Going to kind of miss the camps. I definitely do prefer the camp movies and the Friday... Well, I prefer, as a setting, the camp movies. But that being said, the Lake House is fine. It's also got a big barn next to it. So, you know, the barn, people can run off in there and get killed without anyone noticing. The barn's much creepier, and it helps spread the characters around. And there's some pretty cool moments, some pretty cool, exciting fight scenes in the barn. So that the barn really does help, you know. But anyway, you meet our main character, this summer house. Her and her family used to be there a lot. They used to live there, but something happened, and they've been away for quite some time. Now, the secret as to what's happened is what's driving a lot of her character, and I obviously won't say what it is. When you finally find out, it does imply something pretty dark, even though it doesn't say it outright. And it's a bit of a tonal shift, especially because this is one of the wackier movies, and the explanation is just a little tonally off. But that being said, pretty dark, and I see why she was upset for so many years. She comes back, and you meet her old boyfriend. Her old boyfriend didn't want things to end when she moved away, really glad to have her back, and wants to pick back right up where they left off, but she doesn't know if she's 100% ready for that. And he's like, we lost so much time, we gotta get started again really soon, but she doesn't quite know if she's ready there. So a little bit of a back and forth there. The other characters, there's a lot of, you know, stereotypical horror movie slasher characters that aren't super memorable. You do get a stoner couple, which is a little too comedic and over the top for me. They're not terrible. It just felt like, you know, they're trying to do a bit like, hey, wouldn't it be funny if we had stoners in here? Not really my favorite characters in the series, though, but some people might find them funny if you're like Cheech and Chong fans or something. But the one character that this movie is really, really known for is Shelly. Shelly is a lot of people's favorite character in the whole series. He's really relatable and really developed, and the thing is, in a lot of the Friday the 13th movies, it's kids going out and partying, you know? But this is a kid who wants to go out, wants to party, wants to be socially accepted, but is just socially awkward and doesn't get it and keeps missing. And that's probably more relatable than it should be. But he goes and he pulls pranks. He wants to scare people, and they just keep getting annoyed. So it's, in a really ironic twist, what he does trying to get people to be with him and stick around him more, and, you know, what he does to be part of the group is what's pushing people away, which is pretty deep and really tragic, and you really do feel for this guy. And he's such a good character. They try to set him up. They're like, hey, we'll get you this girl. She can be your date the whole time. And you can tell pretty quickly she's disappointed. And that really does hurt. But he tries his best. And you can see the two almost clicking and just not quite working. And you're like, oh, I want this to work better than it is. But Shelly just is so off base, you know, and you really feel for the poor guy. And without spoiling how his plot ends, it is kind of fitting because he is such a fan favorite character, what he winds up giving to the series being something very important. And, you know, you'll see when you get to the end what he drags out of the lake. So yeah, he's a really relatable character. You also do get this scene where Shelly and the girl that's going to be his date go into town and accidentally have a kerfuffle with some biker gangsters. I wasn't the biggest fan of these gangsters because the idea of Friday the 13th is it seems like a peaceful lakeside camp. You're not supposed to know about a struggle. Having a bad guy element in the forefront really does take away of the contrast of peaceful lake that's secretly where a killer lives. And the contrast being there, I felt, was kind of important. And having these gangsters as an upfront threat, I really wasn't the biggest fan of that. But I do see their point, and they do some really good things later in the movie. This adds to the body count. It adds a little bit to the plot and helps shake things up. But also, it gives Jason some people to fight that are supposed to be of a tougher caliber. Once again, helping Jason look big and strong by taking down some big and strong bikers. So, give him a tougher enemy to fight than a summer camp counselor. So I do see why they're there, and I do get that. This movie does have some pretty good kills in it as well. You know, you get the famous upside-down kill. Again, I want to allude to these without spoiling them. And you do get the scenes in the barn, a really good run around in the barn, especially near the end, so some good slasher action there. But you get a lot of 3D kills, which, especially if you're not watching in 3D, a little cheesy. They're actually pretty cheesy by today's standards. You get the famous Jason shooting the spear gun and the spear going right at you. There's that. There's also the famous eyeball kill where the eyeball pops out. And watching it again, I realized, oh man, the eyeball kill is for a pretty major character. A really, really important character gets a pretty goofy death. It's a memorable death. It's an iconic death. It's pretty goofy, and to see one of the main characters get such a silly death, a little, not super great. But when talking about the other cheesy 3D elements, it's sort of the thing you kind of have to go back and forth on. It's like, you're seeing a 3D movie, you want to see some stuff pop out at you. I mean, if you go and see a 3D movie and nothing really pops, it's almost like, what's the point? Of, you know, especially for a while there when everything was in 3D. You do a 3D movie that's just a regular movie and it doesn't have any of those bits, you're like, why did I even see it in 3D? Yet almost always when they do these bits, it almost always comes off as cheesy. So I don't know what to go do there. It's kind of a back and forth. But they think of any little thing. You know, there's one scene where the characters are juggling and they put the camera up in the sky so the fruit that they're juggling goes right at you. One of the stoner characters offers you a joint, offers the camera a joint and holds the joint right into the camera. There's a scene where they're popping popcorn and of course the popcorn flies right at the camera. And there's any number of little things, you know, someone killed and you see the axe handle and the camera pans right by the axe handle so it gets in your face. Fun, cheesy, 3D gimmicky stuff. It does feel cheesy and gimmicky, but at the same time, like I said, it does make it for a funner atmosphere. And this is also really the movie where Friday the 13th learned to have a little fun. And, you know, you kind of need that element, you know. And this, you wouldn't quite get this level of cheesiness till like part 6 again, where part 6 kind of knew it was funny and did a whole bunch of that stuff. So this is one of the cheesier movies. It's still a pretty good movie. Like I said, part 1 and part 4 are my favorites. It has some good kills. It has some good moments. The characters aren't 100% perfect except for Shelley. But there are some interesting ideas. The final girl's pretty well developed. It's just, you know, the franchise isn't quite at full swing here, but it did finally get the iconic tank version of Jason, which will play out really well, and especially cool to see him in part 4 next time around, really unleashed because they thought it would be the final chapter. So it sets up a lot, and this movie is the movie that would ground the franchise in a solid direction and just send it rocketing forward to make, let's see, 9 more theatrical movies. So even though this is cheesy, it did its job super effectively, and there are some really fun moments, and it put fun in the series. It put proper Jason in the series. There's a lot to like here, and it is, you know, it's not the best, but it's still pretty fun, and I really did like it. So overall, part 3 is pretty cool, and again, another case of maybe I rambled on for a bit, but to everyone who's watched so far, thank you for watching. To everyone who's liked and subscribed, thank you. You're really helping the channel out. If you want to see more, I'll put a relevant playlist on the bottom. That will probably be a Friday the 13th playlist. So if you want to see my reviews for Friday the 13th Part 1 and 2, they'll be there, as well as a complete DVD Blu-ray collection. and maybe some other things, and I'll obviously make more in the future. Anyway, have a good day. I'll see you guys again very, very soon. Relevant playlist on the bottom. Have a good day now.